Hello and welcome back to the reading of The Puzzle, A Gift from Spirit with Kelly Allen. And I'm continuing to go through the chapter titled Death and Moments of Clarity. In the last segment, I talked about my friend Carrie that had passed away, and now I'll be moving forward with talking about my twin brother who is also named Carrie. And I'll just jump right in. In 2001, I lost another Carrie. Of course, different spelling. This Carrie was my twin brother. In his battle to survive cancer and in his death, Carrie also taught me many lessons. Without going into a complete history on my twin brother, I'll just say that we were extremely close in early childhood, but we went in entirely separate directions in our teen and early adult years. We always loved each other, but we didn't always see eye to eye. Unfortunately, Carrie went through a tough time in his life in which the drug methamphetamine had taken possession of him, and it caused a great deal of pain for him and his family. The good news is that he ultimately went into a rehabilitation program where he became clean and sober. Before treatment, Carrie's habit was causing him to act out in erratic and abusive behavior. There were times when we all feared Carrie's tendency to act in unpredictable and destructive ways. The situation got so bad that toward the end of his drug use, Carrie's wife Debbie and their three children stayed with Lee and I for approximately 8 or 9 months. No one in the family knew where she had gone, but she would make an occasional call from a payphone to let everyone know that she was all right. Fortunately, taking the kids and leaving was the best thing Debbie could do for Carrie, and it was the catalyst for him to finally seek treatment. Together with a number of friends, we had gotten Debbie into an apartment, furnished it, stocked it with pots and pans, silverware, and other kitchen utensils. We stocked the bathrooms with towels, washcloths, and all the personal items needed. We stocked the fridge and the pantry and made sure she had everything she needed to make a brand new start. As a group, we collectively had a housewarming party and decorated the apartment for her. Within a month of Debbie moving into her apartment, Carrie completed his treatment program and contacted her. Against our advice, Debbie immediately took Carrie back and he moved in with her. She told us that she believed in him and she trusted her gut feeling. At this particular point in time, she had more faith in Carrie than the rest of us. Thank God she did. When Carrie returned to Debbie and the kids, he came with an entirely new appreciation for them. He found a renewed gratitude for family and spending time together. Holidays, and especially Christmas, became special for them. The children went from fear-stricken to being empowered by Carrie's transformation. He was living as an example of what the power of love could do, and he was consistently demonstrating his love for them. When we visited Carrie and Debbie's house, we greeted and departed each other with hugs. This was something not common in our family growing up, and a welcome new tradition. As fate would have it, the time of celebration was not long-lived. Carrie was diagnosed with cancer. Although at the time he was working for an asphalt paving company, he didn't have insurance, and getting through the red tape involved in trying to obtain approval from the state for treatment would prove to take the one thing he couldn't afford to lose: time. Once again, the passing of a loved one, however painful, proved to provide an awesome lesson and miraculous experience. Watching Carrie succumb to cancer was much like that of our other friend Carrie when AIDS slowly took its toll on him. Carrie gradually lost weight, then the ability to walk, and he was ultimately bedbound. I'm very grateful for the hospice organization that provided the needed assistance for him so that he could spend his final days at home with his family. When we and others spent time with him, he was in the comfort of his own home, and this made a world of difference in the quality of the visit for him. In spite of his deteriorating state, Carrie possessed a sense of pride in his latter days. He had gone from carrying shame for his past actions to a sense of gratitude for having been given the opportunity to show his wife and his children that he could turn his life around and demonstrate what it is to do the right thing. When faced with the choice of drugs or his family, he chose to fight and cast out his own demons. The program he participated in wasn't an easy one, nor was the challenge of purging himself of the toxins that he had been addicted to for so long, but he made the decision to do so, and he did. Carey found an entirely new way of looking at his family, the world, and spirituality. His emotions ran deeper than they had ever run before, and for the first time in his life, he wasn't ashamed to cry. In the past, he would have considered it to be a sign of weakness, but now he cried in sorrow and he cried in joy. For the last couple of weeks of his life, What a Wonderful World by Louis Armstrong, which was later played at his funeral, became Carey's favorite song. Even in his observations in his last few days, he would stare out of the window and remark how blue the skies were, how green the trees were, and he would revel in the total captivation of nature. His body was dying, but his spirit was quickening, and his appreciation for the moment was undeniable. He was beginning to teach those of us who would pay attention. On the night the hospice worker told us that Carey was certain to pass away, I offered to stay at the apartment. He insisted that I go. When I told him I wanted to be there for him when he passed, he said he knew I was tired, and again he insisted that I go. I explained that as twins we came into this world together, and if we can't go out together, then the one to go first should have the other present. He insisted I go and promised me that he would not leave until he saw me again. I pleaded with him not to make promises that he couldn't keep. He again promised me that he would not leave until he saw me again. He had also previously promised that when he did pass, he'd provide us with a sign to know that he was fine. I finally agreed and I went home. Early the next morning, before my alarm clock had gone off, the ringing phone woke me. By now, I was so in tune with the phone, I don't even think it rang twice before I answered it. On the other end of the phone was Debbie, Carey's wife. She said that according to the hospice nurse, Carey appears to be in the final stages of his life. I quickly got dressed and headed over. When I walked in the door of Carey and Debbie's apartment, I had a clear shot of the love seat in which Carey lay with his legs up and over one end. Debbie was on the other end of the love seat, standing and crying, and my mom, who had stayed the night, was standing behind the back of the love seat. As soon as my mom saw me, she went down to her knees in tears. I looked directly at Carey, believing he had already gone. He opened his eyes, looked up at me, smiled, and exhaled his last breath while his eyes closed for the final time. He had kept his promise. It was a while before the representatives from the coroner's office came to pick up Carey's body. I was able to move his body from the love seat to the sofa so that he appeared to be in a more comfortable state. Carey's children, Jeff, Michael, and Tim, were then allowed to come out into the living room to pay their respects. This was a terribly confusing and difficult time for all three of them. The staff from the coroner's office finally arrived and moved Carey onto a gurney to take him to the morgue. Carey was about to keep another promise he had made. He had promised that he'd provide us with a sign after his passing to let us know he was fine. As he was being taken out of the upstairs apartment and down the stairs, one of the many individuals now present shouted, "Look, look up there!" Approximately 15 to 20 feet directly above Carey's body was a hawk circling. As he was moved down the stairs, the hawk continued to follow, maintaining a circling presence above him. Even the staff of the coroner's office stopped at the bottom of the stairs to watch. While we all stood looking, the hawk began to ascend higher and higher while still circling above Carey's body. All at once, the hawk appeared to transform into a ball of white light and shot straight up and disappeared from sight. If there hadn't been so many of us witnessing the event, I wouldn't have believed my own eyes. I share this and the other stories because I have come to realize that even when taken by disease, accident, or natural causes, death is a natural part of our human experience. Not only that, but if we pay attention, it's as miraculous as birth and equally cause for celebration. Carey demonstrated in his promise to me that he would see me again just how much that he had come to realize he was in fact in control of his life. There is a powerful message to be understood here. Through his choices, Carey may have brought discomfort and consequences to those lives he touched, but he provided ample opportunity for lessons in patience, compassion, unconditional love, understanding, and even empathy for those who have been in his shoes. He was able to live a life of incredible contrast and experience. Had he been portraying a character in a movie or television drama, he would have been worthy of an award for his performance. Perhaps in the big picture of things, his performance in the grand drama of life has been rewarded, and he continues on his spiritual journey. So I'm going to go ahead and stop with the reading there, and then I'll have one more segment for the chapter Death and Moments of Clarity, where I share two more stories of individuals that have passed and the impact they had on our lives. Thank you again for joining me, and I truly do hope you're enjoying the reading of The Puzzle, The Gift from Spirit.